do not run bird embed certification. They just estimate the number of population. But this is very often used, and we use it for development of mortality trend also follow. You can do this again specific by age, specific by disease group, specific by income, by employment, whatever. But it is always based on birth and mortality registration, the death certificates. Again, it is speaking, yeah, birth is something positive because we believe people will live healthy. But mortality, people say this is the most precise measure of health, but unfortunately we cannot change it. So for health promotion, for disease prevention, mortality is fine, but it's too late. You cannot do anything. It's over, unfortunately. We're looking for something else. We use self-perceived health through questionnaires. Those of you with interest in behavioral health, other measures of population health, you know about this. Very frequently people are doing questionnaires among healthy population, sick population, how do you perceive? So how is your health? And we use this increasingly. The trick is, or the trick, the uncertainty, one of the many uncertainties is that, you know, there are studies when they try to measure objectively a disease incidence in a region and self-perceived health. And sometimes it works. So if you have a low disease incidence, the population will tell you that we feel healthy, we are okay. But we have regions here in Europe when it goes exactly the opposite. The population is very sick, but they are proud and strong people, and they say, we feel healthy, we are okay. It's again, not an objective measure. It's collected through questionnaires. It's sensitive to your individual feelings. I mean, if you ask me today, how is your health? I tell you it's terrible because everything hurts because I'm preparing for a marathon run on Sunday. So really, even my hair hurts now. But otherwise, I hope I'm healthy, because otherwise I will not survive someday. So it's not really an objective measure, self-perceived health, but we use it. It's one of the good ones. We calculate life expectancy, and we present life expectancy. Policymakers like it, countries like it. There is a, sometimes I feel there is a competition among countries that we gained half year in life expectancy. Yeah, we did too. We are better. We are number one in the world. We are number 103 in the world. You know, life expectancy we use very often. But what is life expectancy? That's a statistical calculation based on mortality registration. So we go back to death certificates, and we have a life table simple in Excel, and we calculate life expectancy. This number doesn't exist. It's just our calculation. But it helps somehow to rank countries and see the progress. We use standardized mortality ratios. If we want to compare two populations of different age structure, then we take one age structure and we standardize. And we know that population A is better off as the other population. But we use it based on one measure. It's cancer mortality, it's overall mortality, it's, I don't know, mortality due to traffic accidents, whatever. It's always about one measure. Always about one measure. One effect. And standardized incidence ratio, the same. And you can list a lot of these kind of measures, usually oriented to one effect, or calculated different way, or assessed through questionnaires. But they are all linked somehow to disease. Somehow to disease or a disease outcome. So these individual measures, they do not really allow for a so-called composite, if you want, umbrella type estimation. So what is the health status really of a population? How much people suffer due to a disease? How much people lose from their quality of life, from their life course, if you want, due to disease? So how is their health? What is a burden on their shoulder? What is a burden on their health? Also, how can you link this to broader determinants of health? I mean, it's very hard to link a disease incidence to broader determinants of health. You can link lung cancer incidence to smoking, But is this smoking caused by environment or individual habits or economic determinants, the cost of cigarettes? That's really hard to calculate. That's really hard to express what is the major issue on this. Health economists like to add to this, what is the value of 1 year? How can you, you know, if you, someone, what is the economic value of 1 healthy year? What is the economic value of lost half year or 2 years due to disease? How do we add this? People started to feel end of 90s that we need some new measure where we can put all this together into one number. You know, it's very optimistic. It's enormously optimistic, and there are a lot of uncertainties. But bring all these thinking somehow into one number, which we can use, compare internationally, base our health policies on this, base our public health policies on this one number, and present it, and still it has to give some meaning, some sense. So they said, okay, if we are going to this challenge, to make such a number, then we should really start thinking about health, not on disease, because we have disease measures, but on health, and think about health as the prerequisite to quality of life. You remember my short lecture on determinant of health, how this changed over time, that health is not the main aim of the life. The main aim is to live a high quality life, full potential. So what is the burden? What is really the disease burden? And what causes that burden? How can we express this by one number? How can we bring this thinking quite broad, really, really broad, including everything possible, into one single number? And this led to the born of the Global Burden of Disease Study, end of 90s, or not the end of the first calculation was done in 1990, so rather end of 80s. And people who did this thinking and created the number, they decided to call it the DALI, the Disability Adjusted Life Years. And this is the measure used now globally. This is an example, how do we use it, before I go into the calculation, before I go into the concept. And this shows, for example, DALIs per 1,000 capita per year attributable to water, sanitation, and hygiene. So using the DALI here, DALI means Disability Adjusted Life Years. Here you can see the percentages from 0 to 120. DALIs lost per 1,000 population in different parts of the world. Now, this means, if that's what I'm going to explain in the next slides, what does this mean? That how do we interpret these lost years? You see that in some countries, the water, sanitation, is hygiene is so well solved that basically people are not dying or not losing healthy years due to bad quality water. But in some countries, 120 years of a life are lost for 1,000 people per year. That's really a bad situation. That is really something to deal with and work on improving water, sanitation, and hygiene issues in these countries. And you see the heterogeneity all over the world, so naturally we know the most critical part, unfortunately. So the global burden of disease concept was first published in 1996. It constituted, and now I can really say this in past time, because now there are new sets of data and new calculations. This is ongoing work, as you will see. The most comprehensive and consistent set of estimates, please remember this word estimates, of mortality and morbidity produced before 1996. It is an estimate because I said at the beginning that still more than half of the countries of the world do not have birth and death certification. So the numbers entering DALI calculation are based on estimates. I mean, Denmark has birth and death certification. So they provide exact numbers and calculate at least for Denmark based on exact numbers. But we have, I think last spring it was 110 countries or how many do not have birth and death certification. So they only estimate the number of population. That's why these, the global burden of disease will always be an estimate until everybody has really correct birth death certification. There are a couple of these summary measures of population health. We call them summary or composite measures, if you want, because they bring together everything into one number. We are going to deal in this class and later on in global health specialization with the DALI only. We might mention some of them. It's good for you to know the others, but don't worry too much with them. They are based on very much on the same concept, but they calculate something different. And that's the reason I think this will be confusing enough if I just speak about DALIs, if I would add the others, that can be really, really a mix up in these numbers. The QALY is the quality adjusted life years. DALE is the disability adjusted life expectancy, so you modify life expectancy data. Recently, especially within the European Union, they are doing a lot of work on HEALIs, the healthy life years. And they include only really time lived in health, enormous differences between 28 countries of the European Union in HEALIs. But the global burden of disease study, and we here are going to deal only with DALIs, the disability adjusted life years. The DALIs measure health gaps as opposed to health expectancies. So it measures the difference between a current situation and the ideal situation, where everyone lives up to the age of standard life expectancy and in perfect health. That sounds, I hope, simple. Even more simplifying it, everyone, every newborn is expected to live 80 years for men, and 80 if it is a boy, 82.5 if it is a girl. That was set arbitrarily by the group of experts who started the global burden of study. Please remember this, we will come back to these numbers. 80 for men, 82.5, no respect whether you are born in Sierra Leone or you are born in Denmark. It's the same life expectancy. Everybody is based on the genetic background, based on human biology, expected to live. That's the first part. And in perfect health. It means you are born and you die, I'm a man, so 80 years old, exact on my birthday, and I've never been sick. And probably I got hit by a meteorite falling down from the space, and that kills me. So I die in full health. It's theoretical, it's ideal. I'm, of course, I'm making a bit of anecdote in this, but that's what we mean. So every day of the 8 years, a man will live in perfect health. This is the ideal status we compare to. And this is the ideal status where we take out those years, but this is not true. So that's why we say, if we measure by DALIs, we measure the health gap. How many years we lose compared to this ideal 8 years in full health. You might expect that it contains these two elements. It's very simple calculation. In principle, it's enormously simple calculation. The philosophy behind is much more complicated and then the interpretation, naturally. The DALIs consist of two parts, as we simply call them, the YLL and YLD part. The YLL is the years of life lost due to premature mortality. It means, again, I'm a man, 80 years I am expected to live, I die 65, so I lost 15 years. That year, when I die, they will add me into DALI calculation for the country where I live by 15 years. I caused 15 years lost on YLL. YLD is the years lived with disability. I mean, the first is easy. The first is easy to calculate. The second, the years lived with disability, is not that easy. That, and we will go into this in a second. So this aims to sum up, through all these 65 years I lived, how many years I was sick. But bigger disease, smaller disease, hospitalized, just staying home, whatever, but I was sick. It means I couldn't live in full quality of life. I had some restriction. I had some burden on my shoulders, if you want. And that I didn't use the whole potential to live in high quality life. Here you have a simple formula for YLL calculation. Of course, this is number of deaths and the standard life expectancy, age of death, so the difference from the standard. This is really easy to put together. If you have the population in Excel, and you can calculate it. There are softwares for this naturally, so don't worry with the calculation. The YLD is the number of incident cases, the disability weight, and the average duration of disability. As expected, this is much more complicated. I mean, again, the two of the three, it's easy. Number of incident cases. If you go to health insurance registration, if you go to patient registry here in Denmark, you get the number of incident cases. For every disease, please remember, this is not disease specific. You can do disease specific if you want, but the aim is to do for every disease. Put it together. And the average duration of disability, that is also a problem. Because it, you know, if I call the unit Monday after holiday now, holiday week, that I'm sorry, I'm feeling bad, so I stay home. A second day I'm still feeling bad, I stay home. So how do you calculate this? It's never in the records. So there are some uncertainties to get this average duration of disability. And these are the uncertainties with the dummies, of course, and we will come to all these points a bit more specific. But still, it proved to work. Internationally, globally, it proved to work. So this is how it is calculated. Now, the major issue in this formula is the disability weight. Because naturally, if I call, bless you, the unit that I feel bad that I am not coming. Okay, is it the same if somebody has a high blood pressure, for example, and has to be hospitalized? It's not the same disability. Or somebody has an amputated leg and lives with these years, and I just call that I feel bad, that's not the same disability. If somebody has a mental disease, and somebody has cancer, it's not the same disability. So we need to put some weight on these disabilities to get some more objective numbers. I hesitate to use the word objective, but more objective numbers. So we created, or experts created, the disability weight. And the disability weights are on the scale from 0 to 1. Please, in quality, this I put it here, it might confuse you even more, but just remember that it's opposite in quality of life, quality measures. In DALIs, by bold, that is important. In DALIs, we use 0 is perfect health, 1 is death. So you try to assign, because DALI measures the loss of health. That's the reason why it is so, that 0 is health, death, and 1 is perfect, 0, yeah, 0 is perfect health, and 1 is death. And you move on this very small scale. Whether you are estimating the disability fate for a cancer, or an ordinary flu, or Ebola, or whatever, you move on this scale from 0 to 1. Naturally, if you would do this calculation, you do not set your own disability weight. These disability weights are set now, and there are a group of experts internationally continue working to make them more precise. It's not an easy job, but the measure can be only more correct if we get these disability weights more correct. They were developed by a small group of medical and public health experts at the beginning, based on judgment of the severity of the condition. and the preference for time spent at each severity level. So how much the disease is taking out your capacity to live in full potential. They try to estimate this for every disease and put it on the scale 0 to 1 relatively. Not an easy job. At the beginning it was a small group of experts. At the moment I think the official group working on DALIS globally stretches all over the world, and it's around 600 people who are doing this work and continue and make it more precise. I'll come to the group later. Naturally you need to define some elements to assess the disability, because otherwise everybody would use something different to give a weight to a disability. And the global burden of disease defined these 8 core domains of health as mobility, you are able to move normally around. Self-care, you are able to take care of yourself, shopping, you know, the daily activities. Pain and discomfort, that you feel pain, or you just feel that, I'm sorry, I'm feeling bad. That's not really pain, that's just a discomfort. But it is important. Cognition, and I'm unable to concentrate today, I'm sorry, I have a headache. Totally unable to concentrate, I'm unable to think, I'm unable to write. I can sit in office, but it's useless. Interpersonal activities, I'm able to go out with friends, sit down and spend some funny time. Vision, you know, I see, so I can see you very well, but to read this here, that's a problem for me, so I would get some disability weight based on vision. Sleep and energy. This is the big, big issue, the insomnia, I think it's called. We have a problem to sleep more and more. And affect. These 8 core groups are estimated when the group of experts assigns a disability weight to every disease known in this world. And then there is the calculation on this. So this is the concept. Any questions to this? Is it? It sounds quite easy, isn't it? No, I mean, before I go to this, before I stopped here, because then I'm going to question everything what I said, naturally. So it's good to be sure that you got this. I think the key point is really this here, and that we have a standard life expectancy set. The YLL is not a problem at all, because that's easy. You just calculate the number of years lost. Naturally, you might say, what if someone lives 82, or 80, as a man 82, or 90, or 110 now? Of course, then it is plus. Because you don't calculate this for individuals, you calculate this for your population. So in case of Denmark, for 5.3 million. I would never do DALIS even for a city. I would be very careful. I had once a colleague in Slovakia who was considering to do DALIS for the second largest city in Slovakia and measure the differences between different districts of the city, and I very strongly discouraged her. Don't do this. You can feel that there is a lot of uncertainty in this, especially on the YLD part and disease. And you get this more correct, more precise if you go to larger populations. So to me, to calculate DALIS a country is the minimum size. Naturally, you might argue that, okay, but we have countries with millions of people, and we have Denmark with 5.2, or we have Lithuania with 1.7. Yes, but still the country is the sensible size to calculate DALIS. And if a country you have, quite a lot of centenarians, people living over 100 years, they will add the positive DALIS, so they will decrease the years of life lost. Because of those who die earlier, as the standard life expectancy is. Standard is the arbitrary, let's just rather call it the arbitrary life expectancy. It would be nice if it would be standard. So the YLL part is easy, really. The YLD part is a bit more complicated because of getting the information about the single diseases, single disabilities, and the uncertainty around the disability rate. Yes?
Because we saw the picture before where we saw how many had, you know, most days lost Yes. Yeah. And the dark countries are those I would suspect also were the ones who was bad at reporting legislation.
Yeah.
Yeah. So couldn't you say that there's kind of a, I can just see some problems in that if you just expect that they live less good because of some, if you know what I mean.
Yes, yeah. That's one of the uncertainties of data. Really, the data we know, this is estimate. This is estimate and it's coming based on the best knowledge about mortality in the country and about disease incidence. So naturally you can expect that those countries do not have vital registration, so mortality is not based on real numbers, it's estimated mortality. What they usually do, they collect data on the largest city, the capital, and based on this they estimate for the whole country. And that number is provided. So there is, it's not, you should not think that it's totally just a number like this. No, no, there is some base for this number. But it's not that precise as if you use Danish data, for sure. The same is true with the water, with provision of water and hygiene and sanitation. So you have a systematic error basically in this. So yes, you are right, it's the same countries. It's the same countries, but as both sets, the exposure, the risk factor set, the water, hygiene, sanitation in this case, and the health probably has the same error when the error is equalized, and it's quite valid. But there are other points with this, and it's not on the slide, because that's a hidden discussion. There are different opinions, but I intended to start with it. That what do you think? Is it fair to use the standard or arbitrary 80 for men, 82.5 for women, even if we know that most of, now I say openly, African countries have a life expectancy, the real life expectancy, at maximum around 60, 62. Is this fair to compare internationally and they say that how many life years studies they are losing, but we know that they are far, unfortunately, from 80, 82.5, whereas the northern part of the world is close to 80, 82. So you know what I mean, artificially we are increasing the number of studies for some countries, whereas the others are always on top. So here first and then first.
Yeah, I guess it's fair because our potential as humans is to live to age to end 82. We as westernized countries has also been part of the reason why these countries are not able to develop as for instance as we read in the book, the globalization and the trading and all that stuff. So I guess it's fair to...
That's the aim of Dalits, exactly. And that's why we use this arbitrary, although we know they are far from this. It's an ambition. Dali is an ideal measure. We are measuring to ideal state. And we, if someone is able to live 82.5 in one part of world, then it must be possible for others in other part of world. So exactly this is the point, the equality, the equity issue, very good interpretation. Yeah, thank you. This is very, very important. Because very often you will find these debates, even in international literature, that it's unfair and all this kind of stuff. No, it's an ambition. We must be able to achieve this everywhere. That's why we work in public health, that's why we should work in policy and all around the globe. There are some other social choices, dilemmas linked to Dalits. These are just illustrations. If you go to literature and you search about Dalits, you will find a lot of literature. I just picked up the main points here. Sometimes Dalits give the feeling that, if you, and this is the related to economic, healthy life gained now is worth more to society than a healthy life gained sometimes in future. For instance, in 20 years. I tell you honestly, I don't know where this comes from. Probably from the era of health economists or economists, because they use dollars. They set a value, an economic money, a monetary value to every dollar. And then naturally, because we know that money is losing value in history always, we still didn't, our economists didn't turn it the opposite way. So that would initiate this thinking that, okay, but one healthy life here now is more worth as it will be in 20 years. And economically, you can easily get this point if you use DALI as an economic measure. But from health and human view, I don't think so. I think it's the same all over the history. The human life is a human life, and we have to try to live healthy and provide every condition that people can live healthy. So, but these dilemmas exist. Lost years of healthy life valued more at some ages as the others. What if you have if you put this in formal, if you imagine you have a 75-year-old or 79-year-old man, and it's one week disabled by flu, and then you have a 20-year-old man, and it's 1 week disabled by flu, how much these two contribute to DALI? It's automatically 70 years difference, or close to, no, not 70, 59 years difference to DALI, mathematically. Because the 20-year-old, he still have 60 years to live until 80, but the 79 only 1 year to live. So the difference is 59 years in this, in DALIs. And that's the mathematical trick in this, but again, the answer is that no, the value, you in health you don't think about this, because we are not doing DALIs because of value of life in terms of economic. But economy, if you add the economic value, then they might think about this. A 79-year-old man is unlikely to work in any industrial setting. Usually 79-year-old people are retired. A 20-year-old is at the beginning of career, and this person is going to produce a lot of economic values for the society. But in terms of the numbers, the disability rate is the same for the 1 week disability of a 20-year-old and a 79-year-old. So these are ethical or social dilemmas behind the DALIs. If you decide to work, I mean, these are, I'm telling them to you just to be aware that it's not as never, it's not the super perfect solution for everything. And you can always find people and groups questioning DALIs because of these uncertainties, because of these possibilities to misunderstand the meaning of values. Equality of people, given age, do all people lose the same amount of health and death, even if current life expectancies vary between population groups? We started this debate. So there are these social issues, not often discussed, but you will need them. If you decide to work with DALIs, I'm sure sooner or later you will need them. Five more minutes and then we take a break, okay. Just try to reach the numbers and then, because the second part, just show illustrations, it will be easier. I said that the aim of the group developing the global burden on disease was also to link somehow the bad health, the burden of disease, to the causes of the burden. So they introduced this term, but you probably already know that the proximal, the diseases and injuries, the proximal causes of loss of health, because they are directly causing the loss of health, and the distal causes of loss of health, the risk factors and the determinants of health. And then based on this, they have the categorical and counterfactual attributions. Again, it's important to consider, because the calculation seems to be simple still, even if you imagine you have a set of disability rates and everything. If you have this, it's easy. But categorical, and even such a death is attributed to a single cause according to defined set of rules. You have a death, you have a death certificate, there is a single cause. And you take the numbers. So a death resulting from a combination of malnutrition and measles, just if you take these steps, in death certificate you have either malnutrition or measles. No one is going to write both. They can if I don't know, in some countries they are in that certificate cause the primary cause of that, the secondary cause, the tertiary cause of that. If it is filled incorrectly, you might find both of them, but in that order, not together. So it's categorical, it's either or, it's only one. But the counterfactual is comparing the future levels of summary measure with the levels that would be expected under some alternative scenario. So what would be the burden of disease if no one smokes in a population? How is this going to change? So you take out one risk factor, you know, you base your calculation on two scenarios, and that's the counterfact. Either everybody smokes or no one, nothing in between. No 50-50, no 20-75, nothing. This is another way how DALIs are often used. Health gap measures, and that is a health gap measure, we use the categorical attribution to attribute fatal and non-fatal burden of disease and injuries. So we say it's the disability is due to this one disease, the death is due to this one disease. It is important because, as you will see, DALIs are calculated as total overall, but they are naturally calculated by disease groups to follow up what is causing. They are calculated by risk factors, the distal causes of death or disability. So all these thinking counterfactual categorical is a further complication when you prepare your data set for calculation. I said there are softwares to calculate, but before you use the software, you need to prepare your data. And then you need to do this kind of cleaning the data and thinking about what is what, where do you assign, and then how do you assign to. If you want to assign a disability score, you have to assign a disease first. You cannot assign disability cause without a disease, because they are linked to the disease. So, 5 minute break now, and then we take, I opened it already. So if you click on that link, it will lead you here. And this is directly the global burden of disease arrow diagram. I have plenty of presentations. I picked up this because I like the visualization of changes over this 20-year time period on one side, and for you, the left side, you have the mean rank 1990, and on the right side for you, you have the 2010 mean rank. It means the share of, oh, I hope not now, please, I like this message, but no. You have the diseases, how many DALIs, or the percentage of DALIs caused by different groups of diseases. This is really, very interactive. You see here, this is both genders, male, female, together. It is global. You can change it for regions of the world, developed Southeast Asia, East Asia, China, North, and others, many others, if you go down. Naturally, you can add more as top 10. You can switch to risk factors. We will do it in a minute, just a little bit of this now. And you can also change the overall DALIs and look at the YLL only, years of life loss and years lived with disability. And this makes a big, big difference, naturally, as you would expect. We can play with some of this, but the interesting first the interesting thing here really that how health develops over 20 years. Some people say 20 years is nothing, but here this is the time period since we have done it. So basically 1990 we started, and the first estimate is here. So these are full DALIs, the both components: lower respiratory infections, diarrhea, disease, preterm birth complications, ischemic heart disease, stroke, COPD, malaria, you can see, read them alone now or later on. 20 years later, you see that ischemic heart disease became the top one killer globally. This is global, remember, it's the whole world, it's not a continent. It's very, very important that this goes down. Lower respiratory infections are still number two, stroke is up. Diarrheal disease is fortunately going down a little bit, far from what we want, naturally. But they are going down, so the trend is not that bad. It is really, there is some progress in global health and the burden, what causes this burden. The biggest jumper still, however, despite all the effort, you see HIV/AIDS, it was number 33 in 1990, now it's number 5. But yeah, you cannot remember this, I remember that this is, you should know that this is 1990, and basically the HIV epidemic, people noticed the HIV epidemic around 1980, 1982, that was when the first cases were discovered. So the first number, number 33, is really, I would say, the pre-epidemic phase, when the world didn't even know how serious is this problem. We just started to learn how serious is HIV, whereas now, 2010, we know very well how serious problem is HIV, and you can also see it in the, on this daily lost, the years of life lost due to HIV. Malaria is a standard killer, unfortunately, and cause of disability. Another big jumper, you see here, low back pain. This is coming up again globally, much more important as it used to be. Road injuries slightly increasing, but if you imagine that this is global, then it's really serious, that the chronic diseases are very serious. Now, if we just change this and look, I don't go to years of life lost because of obvious reasons with the mortality and others, and we all know this, we don't really see a big change, but if you read what bothers us, what causes our daily burden of disease, just see this, this is completely something different as the total disease, and see the stability also, please, that there is not a big change among these. These are constant issues which are taking out our quality of life. They're not killing us, except some cases maybe. But these issues are making our life not that happy as we deserve to have a happy life, a decent life. The Dalis, one of the big pluses of Dali, that they discovered this. Because most of the health policies, I mentioned at the beginning, Dalis can be very, very useful health policies. Now, you know, there is a lot of debate around how long can we expand human life. I heard one of the big moments of my career was that I don't remember, 1997 maybe, something like that, in Florence at the European International Epidemiological Conference, I heard live speaking Sir Richard Doll. Do you know who was Sir Richard Doll? He was the epidemiologist from UK who discovered the link between smoking and lung cancer. Very, very clever man. Unfortunately, he passed a few years ago, but even that time, 97, he was above 80, far above 80, so he was a really old man, but a very clever man, and he had a lecture there. And first, you know, I went to conference also because of other reasons, but one of the top, committed that I have to be there when Sir Richard Doll is going to speak, because I'm interested in epidemiology and he's somewhere there. I cannot even show where is he to me. When he came up, this old man, hardly working, and he said, I'm not going to use PowerPoint. How is my English? What will I get out of this lecture without PowerPoint? So if your English is poor, you at least read the slides if you don't understand the speaker. But in this case, what to do? And then he was speaking, you can hear the flies in the room. He was speaking without PowerPoint. Everybody was listening perfectly and argumenting and speaking all about this. And look, guys, I'm an old man, I can say this. How long you want to live? How the hell long you want to live? Why are we focusing all our health policies on expanding year from 90 to 90 and a half, 91 and similar? Shouldn't we rather focus on increasing the quality of life during these 90 years, for example? That we live in full quality, full potential. Wonderful speech, full, huh? Still speaking through this. Here it is. One of the main reasons of this switch were the Dalis. Because when people calculate Italians and put all this together, then we learn that, gosh, but these things are completely different as those things they are killing us, and we base all our health policies and prevention and everything on the mortality causes. That's fine, we have to do it, but we have to put triple, quadruple, even more effort on dealing with these issues, the mental health issues. They were not on the map before. They came up because of here, major depressive disorder number two. No one ever believed to this issue before 1990. It sounds funny maybe for you, but I can tell you really this was not on the map. People were interested in cancer, people were interested in heart disease and infectious diseases. But mental health, depressive, oh come on, that's nothing, that's not relevant in our society. And then suddenly when they calculate David, then we see that globally, because this is still global, I'm not going to continents, globally, they're number two on the disability. They are taking out our healthy lives. So this is very important element in DALIS, and we still use it very little. I think we have to use it much more. You see only one change here, that falls and diabetes switched place over 20 years. So to speak about trends here is very hard. And I think this is not a good result for public health effort. I would like to see some movements also here, not only in the overall, and if I switch to years of life loss just very briefly, you know, there is some movement. Some is going up, some is going down. But really what bothers us every day, that's the disability issues. And I'm not going to, you can play with this as much as you want, really, anytime. Change the continents, male, female, you can compare time over to 20 years, and if you go to the website of the Institute, you can get the data set, the raw data set, not the raw data set, but the numbers in Excel, and you can do your own charts also on the website. You can probably see the comments also here. So I already said it, but there are some changes in 10 leading causes from 1990. There are some movements, especially if you take the overall studies. Perinatal conditions, depression, ischemic heart disease, cerebrovascular, road traffic are still increasing. These are still, I mean, I mentioned mental has gotten mapped thanks to studies. It's still increasing. Depression is increasing both in disability and it is increasing in mortality because of suicides. Especially now in times of the economic crisis, that some countries are really reporting an increase in suicide rates in countries, and that will have influence on the DALIS, the next calculation. We don't see it yet, because naturally this data is 2010. There is some other point, and this is what we did here, the successful master thesis. I have to be proud to my students, because she did the work and got 12. You know, I posted also for you the epidemiological transition paper. I don't know whether you had time to read it. And the reason is this, that have you heard about the epidemiological transition before? Don't worry, I'm not examining. You have time to read it. You have 2 years now, so that's okay. But don't tell me it is at the end of your studies, please. The epidemiological transition is basically, simple said, the process of moving, the causes of disease, the causes of death, from the relatively simple infectious diseases to chronic diseases, to mental health and all others. And we know this is a fact. The Omran paper I posted is the basic paper on epidemiological transition, and it describes all the phases and everything. Now, again, we just told ourselves with my student, one of my students, that why don't we try to check the DALIS and express how far countries are in epidemiological transition. Even some colleagues when we studied us, and so what? The what is that if our hypothesis is true, that epidemiological transition is moving, this means that the country should reorientate health services. If you move from so-called quick killers, the infectious disease, the diarrheal diseases, they kill people in very young age, infant mortality and this. Then you live longer. And probably in longer age, what happens if you are aging? Well, when people get cancer, do 15-year-old people get cancer? Unfortunately, some, but not that many. But 60 and plus, many people get cancer. Very few, very young people get heart disease and hypertension, but after 45, 50 people get these diseases and they live with it, diabetes. They live with diabetes decades. So if you think in terms of dyings, if something kills you quickly, part of your population, 5%, dies in age one, what's going on in dyings? You get big YLL, years of life lost. These people do not have the chance to develop disease. They do not suffer from disabilities. I'm sorry to say, and I don't mean it ironic or anything. They simply don't have chance to get sick. They are just killed. Terrible. But in terms of DALYs, this means that you have a very low YLD for this population. That was our hypothesis. And we just said, let's look to this. Because then, if we are able to use DALYs to express this, we can tell the country that, look, your country is somewhere here in the epidemiological transition, and if you are a conscious health policy maker, you should know that in 5 years, you will need more social care and long-term care for your elderly, or not only elderly, but the chronically disabled people, the chronically sick people, and you will need less hospital beds for quick killers, the infectious diseases and others. So to us it made sense. Fortunately, it made sense also to the censors, so it ended up a very happy story. And see, what did we find? We created this index, very simple index. Instead of doing DALYs, we just compared the two, the share of YLD and YLL. In high-income countries, and we used this data set, which I'm showing 1990-2010, in high-income countries, over these 20 years, this index changed from 0.77 to 1.22. It means in 1990, it was still, even in the high economic developed countries, the mortality part was higher as the morbidity part, whereas now in 2010, the morbidity part is more important as the mortality part. Africa, sub-Saharan Africa specifically, because the data allows for this by continents, by regions, in sub-Saharan Africa, this has changed over the same time, the same data, from 0.23 to 0.29. So we are very happy, really, because I have hypothesis is proven by this. And it is true that this index really reflects the changes, the level of epidemiological transition. I mean, those countries, again, this is one work, one master thesis, very fresh. We are going to publish it now, and I'm sure it will create some discussion. We say that if it is one, then you are probably far away in epidemiological transition. If it is above one, then you are very much over the epidemiological transition. If you are that low, but you are moving, it means the epidemiological transition is just starting. And you have to start thinking, how do you prepare and plan your health service for the coming years? The DALYs offer enormously a lot of possibilities for this kind of calculations, and they are not yet used. The data is available, this is public data, so you can play with it as much as you want. The master thesis made a set of recommendations. We tried to get her to a PhD, but it requests money, so we will see. But it's open, and I'm sure I will post teams around DALYs, because it even more catched my interest now when we see that our hypothesis was correct. You might discuss also with the YLD, so what is the role of the more precise disability rates? Because this group of people, these 600 experts, they are working daily based on disability rates, and they are trying to get them more correct, more precise. I don't know. This is really a subject for discussion and needs more work to be done and more discussion with those who are doing it. But definitely, I believe that the data, the validity of data 2010 is much better as it was in 1990. Specifically the morbidity part, I'm pretty sure with this, because simply that's the development. Oh, now the disadvantage is that I have to go it this way. Now let's take a look to these factors. It's using the same chart, I just need my eyes, yeah, disability rate, I don't know how big, but big. So if I click here risk, then you get immediately the risk factors. So what causes the, you know, the first was the proximal, the other is the distal causes of burden of disease. The risk factors are the distal causes of burden of disease. And here we see some movement. Here we see some movement, and not that bad. Childhood underweight was the first 1990. You can see now it dropped to number 6. So maybe the Millennium Development Goals have some meaning, and there is some improvement. It's not that bad. Many countries are not going to achieve them next year, but it's not that bad. There is some positive development, really. On other hand, you see the jumper, high blood pressure, and that is another sign of epidemiological transition, really. High blood pressure. When I started public health, we all heard about the North Karelia study from Finland and considered that high blood pressure and heart disease, this is the Scandinavian countries and some of the developed European countries. Now we can see that this is a global problem. It's everywhere, because if it is number 2, then it's very, very clear that this is a global problem. Dietary risk is unfortunately here still, so malnutrition. I would say the dietary risk is tricky. Don't think this is only malnutrition. It can be also the other side of the story. You know, nutrition is a U-curve. It's bad be here, it's bad be here. Under, over. You should try to get in middle somehow. Air pollution, smoking still among first numbers. Yeah. We are drinking more apparently, or it's getting higher in these priorities. Ambient air pollution, exactly the same. High body mass index, the obesity question is here. Again, some good, what can be related probably to the Millennium Development Goals, the breastfeeding. So a lot of health education, a lot of UNESCO and all these international institutions, it pays back. This has decreased from number 6 to number 11. There is still space for improvement, as with everything. But you see these trends that all these global efforts, those people who say nothing happens for all this global effort money, it's not true. A lot of things are happening, and you can see it if you look to these issues. Again, you can... let's ask now something else. Use... Oh, it's even on country level for some parts, you see. Now it don't have the mark here. Oh! Here we are, the risk factors for Denmark, so you can get it even for countries. Here I didn't even know, because it's the time question. Smoking, despite all the effort, is number 1. Based on this dietary risk is 2nd. High blood pressure stabilized. Yeah, obesity slightly increasing. Physical inactivity. I am surprised with this, because I think I don't know a country in Europe where there is such level of physical activity as here. Total cholesterol down, ambient air pollution down, but that is well known that the air here is quite clear. So you can even get the countries here if you want and play with these numbers. Okay, back here quickly. Again, some trends in risk factors. Except the air pollution and breastfeeding, not that many very positive development really. But these two are good, because the breastfeeding shows the validity and the need still for large scale high education, health education, health promotion campaigns. And air pollution shows the value of the epidemiological studies. You know, there was a huge wave of air pollution studies going around the globe around end of 90s. 2000. You still see a lot of publications, air pollution in big cities and different health outcomes. I think it pays back. The limits for air pollution has changed substantially over these 20 years, and we can see this effect. Naturally, industry improved, so there is less pollution also, but this is very, very important. The rest, we can open the question, but we don't really have time, that maybe even bigger changes in risk factors, and of course then in Dalits also after some time, and that can be another research issue, by the way, that how fast after changes in risk factors, the YLL is changing and YLD is changing, because there is some lag time between these two. But the most important is that how much research is done on different parts and how much practice is done on different parts. You know, it's well known in public health that we all like to observe things. We are doing a lot of observational studies. We are doing a lot of analytical studies, case control cohort studies. If you follow the public health literature, you see in every volume, Scandinavian Journal of Public Health, International Journal of Epidemiology, International Journal of Epidemiology, all of them, most of the journals even have a subpart, cohort profiles. Unbelievable amount of cohort studies who analyze a risk factor and the health effect. Try to find a journal where they have a special section on intervention studies. This is what is lacking. This is where we are really poor. We know a lot, we get a lot of information from observations and analysis, but we're not that good in running intervention studies and changing things in practice. That is delayed. That is delayed. I believe if we get this more in balance, then the changes, if we add or you add, it's unlikely I do this, 2030 DALI analysis in 15-16 years from now, then you will see even bigger changes and positive changes, I'm sure. But it depends really how fast we move from observation and analytical part to the intervention part. So, all this global burden of study, you know, one of the most important things on this, because sometimes, depending on country culture, moving from country to country, some countries they say, yeah, this health is public, health must be public funded. The private has nothing to do with this, and that's always, you know, corruption, and similar things. Now, the global burden of disease study is in principle driven by Bill Gates Foundation. They donated a huge amount of money to set up a special institute because of this statement. I'm not going to read it due to the shortage of time. You need, simple, to make valid, sound health policies, you need sound evidence. No way. And fortunately, they understood it in this foundation, and they donated, I think, 60% of funding for this institute for health metrics and evaluation, who is the core institute for DALIS and the global burden of disease. They are the place where all this knowledge is gathered and then distributed. They have partners around the world. If you go to their website, you will find the individual partners. But 60% of funding comes from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and the rest is the University of Washington in Seattle, US. And the aim is really to guide international policy making, high quality data, health needs and outcomes, and assessing the performance of health programs. Because you can also use DALIS naturally to assess the performance of health programs if you have this data available and if the data is somehow verified. So, to conclude, the global burden of that disease is, to me, and I'm not against if you say you don't like it. There's a wide variety of methods. To me, this is a very useful method to assess the burden of disease, not individual disease. You can link it to individual diseases, you've seen in the data, but you get it overall. You can say, what is the burden of disease of the shoulder of your population overall? Then you can split it by diseases. Then you can split it by risk factors. And based on this, recommend your Ministry of Health that can you please do action on depression more, prioritize this higher as something what is now priority. We are not saying you don't need to do, I don't know, salt reduction in food. No, no, keep it. But please focus more on this because this is now the number one on disabilities what takes out the healthy lives of your population. We should focus on this. So from this perspective, the DALI is the global burden of disease is very, very useful model. Naturally, you started the question of the validity of data. I mean, the the very ideal state. Dalits are the ideal state. The ambition, the target, we have to have the same with methodology. The only and the most correct valid data we will have when every country has a mortality morbidity registration. That's the key. Once a country is able to run a mortality, a vital registration, birth registration, mortality registration, the YML part is 100% sure. Then we can say it's 100% sure. Now it's still estimate. There is a lot of writing about this. Last year, a year ago, this year in February, there was a big paper in Nature really criticizing World Health Organization that instead of focusing a lot of work on changing the small disability weights, they should do a work and push countries and governments that have to have a birth registration. Show us. We provide you help. We can provide you technical help, everything. Set up a birth registration. That's a key for you. If you have this, set up the mortality registration. This will improve everything. And the last part always, I said, move from observation to intervention, including the policies. Use this data, please. Use it much more. You would be surprised how many ministries of health in Europe, if you go there and ask them, so do you know what is DALI? How to use this? They will be very, very looking, very strange to you. I'm afraid they don't know most of the bases. They don't know what the DALIs are and how to use it. But that's a task for us. That's a task for us and you to go out and to present the DALIs and interpret the DALIs. What does this mean that we are losing a year of healthy life? Okay? Yes. Questions?